Kathleen Digre. I'm a professor of neurology and ophthalmology here at the University of Utah. And tonight we're going to be talking about the visual aspects of migraine. We won't be covering all the visual aspects, but we'll be covering some of them, the most common aspects. And as you know, we video these so that people who are from our Intermountain area or across the country that would like to come to our lectures but live too far away can still see them and participate. And so we're happy that you're all here to talk about this topic. So I want to convince you that migraine is more than a headache. The headache is the part that disables us, but there are visual aspects that each of us who has migraine can experience, and I want to make sure you know all of these aspects. Now, I want to first just give an overview that migraine is extremely common and headache is even more common because almost all adults will undergo a headache sometime in their life, and 38% of children can have headaches at any one time. So headaches are very common, but 10 to 20% of people are predisposed to get migraine headaches, and of those, about a third of them get auras with their headaches. And we're going to be talking tonight about that aura. What is that? But I think it's just mind-boggling to think how common this disease is. Migraine is 4% of every office visit in to any doctor, more common than asthma and diabetes combined. So we're talking about a very common disorder. It causes trouble for not only the individual who has it, but it's a financial burden to all of us. And the World Health Organization has realized that migraine is in the top 10 most disabling conditions of the world. So if you have migraine, you have a disabling condition, especially if it's frequent and chronic. People ask, well, how do I know if I do have migraine or is my headache something else? My mother and father had sinus headaches, but really that's sort of a term that means that your father and mother probably had migraine, okay? So migraine usually runs in families. How do you know if your headache is a migraine headache? You usually have two of three things. One, the headache is disabling. You have light sensitivity, or you have nausea. If you have two of those three things, that makes it a migraine. Okay? Often people who have migraines are carsick as children. So it tells you that a person with migraine is born with kind of a sensitivity about motion, and that motion is also part of the vision system, because when you see motion, it can trigger a headache. It often makes our thinking fuzzy, and you know, people can work people up and do MRI scans and everything else, and you don't see anything wrong per se in the brain, but it's still something's wrong because there's a dysfunction going on. Now, if you have migraine, you're in good company. Does anybody know who this guy is? Napoleon had migraine. This guy? Thomas Jefferson had migraine. Elvis Presley had migraine. Virginia Woolf had migraine. Queen Elizabeth II had migraine. Whoopi Goldberg has migraine. So if you have migraine, you're in very good company with lots of good people. The migraine is not just a predisposition to get a headache, but the attack of migraine has, I want everybody to be on the same page about it, what an attack of migraine is. So often there can be a prodrome to migraine 1 to 24 hours before somebody gets it. Now, prodromes are things like excessively hungry, excessively thirsty. I've got some people who say, I can absolutely whip the world, and then I know I'm going to get a migraine when I feel super energetic or I feel really good. Or some people say, I start yawning, I am so tired, my brain is fuzzy, I can't think or remember anything, I know I'm going to get a migraine. So that's a prodrome. Tonight we're going to be talking about aura. An aura is a neurologic event that can happen in front of the headache portion But an aura is usually visual, is the most common one, and you're going to be hearing about what an aura is tonight. And then the headache comes on, most of the time it comes on, and that is the peak. That comes after the aura, the headache comes on, and then this is associated with light sensitivity, sound sensitivity, nausea, maybe vomiting, fuzzy thinking, and blurred vision. And that's blurred vision is another aspect that sometimes happens in the middle of a migraine just with the headache piece, and it's not part of the aura, but it's actually part of the migraine itself. And then often after the pain is gone, people can have what's called a postdrome, which means they don't feel well for a few hours to several days. It depends on how the migraine is. But I think it's important to understand that it's inherited, that it's disabling for some people, and that the attack is a whole, it's not just the headache itself. It's how people feel beforehand. A third of people get this aura. Then people can get the pain, and then afterwards there's this kind of residual, the postural. And all of that, I think, is important for us to understand that migraine is more than just the headache. It's complicated. So by way of some cases, I'm going to take you through some cases. These are based on, I've changed the name, but these are based on real people. So Sharon is a 24-year-old teacher. She has a family history of migraine in her mother, and she has attacks of migraine. She has some blurring of vision. She just goes, I feel like I can't see right. Then she has a little spot in her vision, and this spot actually is in both eyes. Now, spots can be in one eye, or they can be in both eyes. And it's important if you do get spots to cover each eye and say, is it in one eye or both eyes? Because if it's in one eye, it's usually something in the eyeball. If it's in both eyes, it'll affect your vision. I always tell my patients to take a book, cover one eye, and you'll see the spot. If you cover the other eye and see the same spot, that's in both eyes and it's coming out of your brain. If you cover one eye with the spot and you can see everything perfectly with your other eye and you don't see the spot, that is coming out of that eye. So it's a way to tell whether it's coming out of one eye or both eyes. So she sees a spot and it's in both eyes because she's covered both eyes and it goes off to the right side. It gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And I'll show you what this looks like, okay? And then the spot will finally go away and she has a throbbing headache with light and sound sensitivity and mild nausea. And she gets these about 2 to 3 times a month. And she said, what is going on and what should she do? And this is a very typical story of a migraine with aura, okay? Migraine with aura. Aura is a fully reversible neurologic event, okay? It's a symptom that indicates something's going on in the brain. And I'll talk about other auras, but the visual aura is the most common aura that people get. It usually slowly develops over 4 to 5 minutes, and it never lasts usually more than an hour. If it goes over that period of time, we are always looking for other things that it could be. Pain may follow the attack in less than an hour, but sometimes you can get an aura and not get the pain. And that sometimes is called acephalgic, or means no headache, or migraine aura without pain. And that seems to happen in people as they get older. So they may have migraines with aura to start with, and then as they get older, they lose the headache part, and they keep the aura. Doesn't seem like, well, at least they get rid of the pain, but they still get the aura piece. So that's what it is. Now, when we see people, we ask about that family history. For example, this person's father had migraine. Many people are carsick as children. And then, then their headaches get worse at various parts of their life. Like they go to college, or they get a job, or they get pregnant and they have children. Lots of more headaches. Okay, then, right, isn't that the truth? Okay. And then, One of the parents died, more headaches. I mean, stressful life events. It's, life is stressful. I mean, we live in a very stressful period of time. Now, if we look at the top graph, there's the attack, you know, the scotoma, the heat wave coming on, the headache coming on, and this is migraine with aura. So this is, and there's migraine without aura, where you don't get the aura before the attack, and that life history is very similar. But I think that it's important to see that the aura comes before the attack, and it's a reversible neurologic event. Now, there are many kinds of auras. The most common are visual, wavy lines. And by that wavy lines, I mean like heat waves. Have you on the highways? Have you ever seen heat waves on the highway when you're driving, and it's kind of shimmering like that? Some people's aura is like that. One of the most classic one is what we call fortification spectra. That's a zigzag line. If you see a zigzag line, it's usually in both eyes because it comes out of your occipital lobe, and we'll talk more about that. There are people who get visual hallucinations, like they could look at somebody and they see the neck elongate or the face go bizarre, or like the eyes are over by where the chin should be or something like that. And who wrote the book? Do you remember who wrote the book about Alice in Wonderland? Lewis Carroll? Lewis Carroll had migraine. And Lewis Carroll based, like, Alice in, remember when Alice's neck grew in the book or in the movie, if you've seen the movie? All these distortions. Or the Cheshire Cat with the zigzaggy teeth? That was part of his aura as well. So he actually had these auras, and he put them in his book. Now, some people can get speech problems. Do you remember seeing the newscaster who got on the news, big national news, and started talking garbage, and she kept trying to talk, and everybody thought she'd been drinking or something like that, but it was her aura to a migraine, and she became aphasic, meaning her language was disturbed, and then she got a terrible headache. Other kinds of auras are vertigo, dizzy auras. And sometimes you can get an aura where you get numbness of your hand or mouth, or even double vision. So auras can be many different kinds of auras, but the most common is the visual aura. Now let's see what that looks like. So this is actually a walled city in Europe. And the way they got the name fortification spectra was because, remember, in the medieval forts, they'd build these little zigzaggy forts that, you know, were the ramparts where they try to keep the enemy out. And then as you got in closer to town, there was another city wall here. But that's fortification is what that word came from, was that fortification spectra. Now, this is an aura that one of my patients, who actually was a family physician, had, and he drew out his aura. So let me, I'm gonna use my pointer here. So you can see, the little, he said it was like a little kaleidoscope of different colors, all the rainbow colors, and see how it gets bigger and bigger, and you can look at the time zone, time here, 3 minutes, 6 minutes, this is up to 10 minutes, and then see how it becomes like a zigzaggy pattern of a line at 12 minutes, and then at 15 minutes, it's way out in his visual field, and then at 20 minutes, it starts to disappear, and by 25 minutes, it was completely gone. Now, he would get these auras without headache. And he wasn't an old person, he was a young person. And some people can get aura, but they're still migraine, without the headache. And he was light sensitive during this time. He said his thinking was just a little bit cloudy. He couldn't quite think clearly when he had that. But you can see the zigzaggy pattern, you can see how it's colored. And he said it shimmered like kind of a kaleidoscope, remember the old kaleidoscopes, he said it just kind of shimmered and moved all the time, and that's a very typical, that's probably the most typical aura. Many of my patients write out that if they're looking at a page, they may see this zigzaggy pattern with the lines, but it obscures what you're looking at. You can't see through an aura. So often the aura will be there, and it's like something's completely missing. It's just like it's gone. If you're looking right here, they've got, and this is the same in both eyes. So that's another way people have described their auras. Now, in Utah, we have a slightly higher incidence of migraine with aura. And many people wonder if it's because we are at altitude, that because of the higher altitude, there's a little bit more motion, mountain sickness, there's, you know, and that the aura may be more frequent in Utah. In fact, we found a prevalence of 48% versus a sea level collaborator, which was 18%. It's quite a bit different. The people say about 30% of people with migraine get an aura, but we're at 40, you know, almost half have an aura. Now, many people will have an aura and then also have headaches without aura. So they can get both. You can get both. You don't have to one or the other. You can get both. And they've thought maybe this is related to oxygen or elevation or barometric pressure. And remember, we have a higher depression and suicide rate here at altitude as well. And that's been shown to be a little bit higher here in Utah, related also to our altitude. So altitude may be playing a role in aura. And if you have auras, you're not alone. Auras are pretty common with people with migraine. Now, where does the aura come from? So, in general, migraine brains are a little different than a normal brain, okay? They're more sensitive. They're more sensitive to light, sound, odor. Anybody who has migraine knows they can smell somebody's perfume 5 blocks away, right? I mean, and like it can be a trigger for a lot of people. And visually sensitive, really visually sensitive, like stripes bug people, like Venetian blinds in sunlight, driving down in the fall when you got all these shadows that can trigger a migraine in so many people. These lights, the flickering that goes on with these lights, that happens with people with migraine more than people who don't have migraine. Not that somebody else can't have some of that, but people with migraine they've got a much more sensitive sensory visual system and a sensory system altogether. And there is a phenomenon that we think is related to aura called spreading depression. Now, you've heard of seizures, right? Where the brain, you know, fires and causes electrical activity in the brain. Well, there's another thing that can happen in the brain, and that's where it kind of goes to electrical silence, like Zippo, okay? Now, in animals, we've seen this occur, and I'm going to show you a video from Casey Brennan, who's a professor here at the University of Utah, and he does experiments on animals and spreading depression, and he drops a drop of potassium chloride, and he, with time-lapse photography, he can see a wave go across the brain. And if he were electrically recording from the brain, he would see that brain go to almost silence and then the recording would come back. But it also, I want you to notice, look at this spot right here. After that wave comes on, see how the blood vessels kind of dilate? So this spreading depression that occurs, which we think is the aura, and it goes much slower than this. It goes about the speed of that aura I showed you that my patient had over 25 minutes, just little bits at a time. Kind of, that's how slow that wave goes. And then it's kind of a dysfunction, and then it kind of goes away. But it couples with blood vessels. And we think that this has something to do with what's going on in migraine, that the aura piece is kind of like a spreading depression. There's a coupling with the blood vessels, and then people get the headache and the throbbing, and then there's probably chemical things that occur at the same time that irritate the nerve endings that go back into the brain. And anyway, this is the process that goes on. Now, everybody goes, well, could this happen in people? I mean, we aren't going to open up people's brains like this and put potassium chloride on them and anything like that, but so I want to show you, this is a video that was done by John Mazziota, who's a professor at UCLA, And the first part of this doesn't do anything, unfortunately, but it, you'll see what happens down the line, but I'll orient you to it. So the aura starts, is really in the occipital lobe. The occipital lobe is your back of your brain, okay? And the very tip of the brain is the very center of your vision, and as it goes in to the brain, it goes to the periphery, okay? So the cortex is our gray matter, okay? And what happened in this study was somebody was in a scanner moving their right finger or something like that to check on what part of the brain was lighting up in this PET study. And this person had the onset of a migraine aura and a migraine in the scanner. So this is like somebody just happened to have this happen to them. And what we're going to see is that this slow activity or this activity spreads from the very tip of the back all the way across the brain. And people think that this is the correlation with that spreading depression that occurred with that migraine. And you know, you've heard of PET studies. They put, you know, deoxyglucose in, and they can monitor. They can watch the activity, the glucose activity in the brain. And it's a fancy technique. It's very sensitive and everything. But what we're going to see here in a second, and unfortunately, the first part of this doesn't move at all, but it should move pretty soon. You're going to see it go from, see a spread go across how this is going. What's interesting to me about this is not the blood flow of the brain at all. In other words, this wave is not going where blood flow territories are, like, you know, the artery to the back of the brain doesn't do all the part that's we're going to see over here. Some of that is coming from the front of the brain, or the arteries that fill the front. So this isn't just a blood flow phenomenon. This is, I think, this is a use of oxygen. It's an energy function that we're going to see here. So I hope this thing will, I know it's a little slow. There we go. Can you see it? See how it just moves across the brain? So this is, it's a real deal. We're not even making this up. You know, this is a real phenomenon that occurs. And so it's just the way this scan was put together. But the blood flow chain or the oxygen utilization is what we were looking at, that red going, it's starting in the back of the brain and going forward. And that's just the direction that aura goes from the very tip of the back of the occipital lobe inward to the brain. Now we want to ask ourselves, how do we treat auras? Well, sometimes we can prevent auras from occurring with migraine medications. So many times we use preventative medications, like even baby aspirin can sometimes prevent migraine auras. Topiramate is another anti-migraine drug and anticonvulsant. Verapamil is a calcium channel blocker that works to prevent migraine auras. Amitriptyline, and there are many other preventatives. Once the headache starts, then we would rely on all of our treatments that we use for acute treatment of migraine. And many of you I know have been to our lecture on the medications that are used by Erica Marini, our pharmacist, gave a few weeks ago. But all of the triptans, and we sometimes will use Midrin or isomethyptine or ergotamine, and then we can treat the nausea. So that's migraine with aura. Any questions about migraine with aura before I go to the next case?
Familiar, that's all.
Huh?
It's not a question. It's familiar.
Yeah, but isn't that interesting how it comes out of the brain and that this is part of the migraine phenomenon? Okay, so next I'm going to talk about a topic that not everybody has with migraine, but some people do. So this is a 17-year-old guy. He's in high school. He's a really good student. He has a family history of migraine, and he has typical migraine with aura. And without aura, about every 3 to 6 months. He gets a typical migraine, he takes his medicine, he does pretty well. But he said he's got some weird symptoms. And he has silvery lines in his vision, floating and squiggly lines, grainy vision all the time, as long as he can remember. He couldn't hardly describe it. It's like pixelated vision, but he could see just fine. But a pixelated vision, that grainy vision. None of you are old enough to remember the old TV sets with snow on the television. Anybody remember that? Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, that's what we're talking about, kind of a snowy vision. And the visual symptoms did not go along with the migraine headache portion at all. And he can see through them. He has these, but his vision is 20/20. I mean, he can see perfectly well through this. And this, I'm going to show you some pictures here. I'm going to use my pointer again. I don't know if you can see this, but this is like that pixelated. It's like grainy pixelation. Can you see that? That's what he, and I showed him these pictures and he goes, yeah, that's it. He would see squiggles, silvery squiggles in the sky when he looked up in the sky. Now those can be floaters in your eye, but for some people these can be really like prominent and disturbing to them. Some people can have a thing called palynopsia, and there's two kinds of palynopsias. One is you move a moving target will give you a shadowy image going behind it, and that people with migraine often can have this palynopsia. A second kind of palynopsia is you look at an object and then you look at it away from it and you still see the object. And that's a second kind of palynopsia. And then there can be, and this one is really hard to see on the screen, these are just like little squiggly or little dots, little sparkle dots that are there kind of all the time, but they don't really affect his vision. And so this is what we call visual snow. Now it's not a common problem, but it's more frequent in people with visual snow are more likely to have migraine or a headache disorder. But it is something that if people have it, they're well aware of it, and they often have it for their whole life. Now, some people just have bits and pieces of it, like they can have exaggerated floaters. So they've come up with some criteria for how do you diagnose it. These continuous little tiny dots in the visual field for at least 3 months, maybe some palynopsia, and then this floater business or little sparkles in the eye, light sensitivity or photophobia, we're going to be talking about that as well. Nyctalopia means you can't see well at night. And then the symptoms are not consistent with migraine with aura. You can see how this is not a neurologic little event followed by a headache. You can see that this is a continuous visual phenomenon that people can have. And then it's not caused by anything else. There are other causes of funny visual symptoms, but this is visual snow. It's seen in men and women, and about 60% of the people who have it have migraine, but almost 90% have some kind of headache disorder. About 20% can have anxiety or depression, and about a quarter of the people with visual snow say that they've had it since childhood, and a lot of them have tinnitus, you know, ringing in your ears. And some people wonder if this isn't kind of a form of like noise in the visual system that occurs. And then there have been studies like PET studies that have shown differences in the brain signal. With him, the first thing I did was tell you, you're not crazy. And you know, because you know, it was kind of like, am I making this up or what's going on? But I said, nope, you're not crazy. This is called visual snow. Medications don't always work for this problem. There are some medicines that seem to work better than others. Lamotrigine, nortriptyline, carbamazepine, sertraline have been reported to work. And just as in light sensitivity, sometimes the blue-yellow filters or FL spectrum filters can help with this symptom, can just lessen it a little bit. The more you think about it, the more you see it. And I bet you almost know that yourself. If you started to look at a blue sky and watch your floaters, and I mean, if you sat and concentrated, that's all you could see, Do you know what I mean? You could just focus on it. And so you kind of have to ignore as much of it as you possible, but people have it for years and years. I've got many, many patients with this. So I've got one guy who still sees colored blobs in his vision that comes and goes, and he has to just ignore these because it's just a continuous phenomenon. What is going on here? We're not sure. But we think it's like tinnitus in the ears. It's like noise in the visual system. And it's more common in people who have migraine. But it isn't a migraine itself. Now, the next topic I want to talk about is light sensitivity. Because everybody, you know, light sensitivity in normal light is called what we call photophobia. Like, we shouldn't be light sensitive in this kind of lighting. Okay? But many people are. And when you have a migraine, during the attack, about 80 to 90% of people have light sensitivity with their attack, where they just want to squint or get into a dark room or put a shade over their eye or something. So it's a very, and you can see this poor woman with a bad migraine. She's got a pillow over her head. So number one, she can't hear her kids, but two, she can't see all the light that's in the room. So it's a very typical symptom that comes with migraine. So here's a woman, who is 35, and she has had very severe photophobia ever since a minor motor vehicle accident about 6 months before. She's not leaving her house because she's so light sensitive, she can't do that. She has had migraines all of her life, previous history of migraines. She's wearing dark sunglasses almost all the time, even indoors. And she's come and had an eye exam, which is normal, and a neurologic exam, which is normal. And so she's somebody, and she's got a kind of a continuous dull headache going on all the time. Well, all of us have a threshold for light sensitivity. Think about yourself going out to let's say you go to a matinee in the afternoon and you watch the movie and it was a great movie and you come out and what happens if you're coming out in the middle of the daylight? We're all going, oh man, it's so bright. And then we kind of get used to it. But some people with migraine, that light sensitivity, you know, is there all the time. It's not just like going from a matinee dark room to a lighted room, but it's there all the time. But think about that. That can be a very disabling thing. And there have even been some papers that have been written saying that if people wear sunglasses inside all the time, they're more likely to have functional visual loss, meaning they have visual loss that's not physiologic, not based on any kind of real visual problem. And so there are many causes of light sensitivity or photophobia. If you have an eye inflammation, you can get very bad light sensitivity. How many of you have ever been sick and really, really sick? You know, high fevers and you get stuff in your eyes and measles. Remember, if anybody ever had measles, you get light sensitive with that. There are retinal causes of light sensitivity. There are brain causes. If you have meningitis, that may be one of your biggest symptoms is light sensitivity. But the most common cause of light sensitivity is migraine, both with the attack and between attacks. So you didn't know that this was a neuroanatomy lesson tonight, but this is all brain and eye neuroanatomy. You know, people say, well, very bad light sensitivity. Do you need vision to have light sensitivity? And the answer is no. We have done studies where we had patients who had no light perception and patients with light perception vision. I mean, they were blind. I mean, they had a cane, or a dog or something like that. And when they had their migraines, they got horribly light sensitive. And some of them were light sensitive even between their migraines, okay? So you don't need to have vision. Well, how could that be? How could it be that you don't even have vision and you could still be light sensitive? Well, there is a cell in our retina that is a very interesting cell. It's called an intrinsically photosensitive ganglion cell. In other words, It just sits there. It doesn't do any formed vision. Our formed vision comes from our rods and our cones and the macula and all that. But these are cells called melanopsin cells, and they only sense light. And frogs have them. Almost every animal in animal kingdom have this cell in their vision. They can sense light. And what's interesting is that this system, this melanopsin system, goes into our circadian rhythm system and makes us know when it's day and night. So it's part of our circadian rhythm. You've heard of circadian rhythm, right? You know when you're going to wake up. You know when you're going to go to sleep. It's part of that system. It's a non-visual system. It just senses light. Its peak spectrum is about 479 nanometers of light, which is in the blue spectrum. So it's very blue sensitive, which is the dominant wavelength at dawn and dusk. Kind of an interesting thing. They've done studies with animals that have melanopsin in their retinas but don't have rods and cones, and these animals are still light sensitive. So they have no formed vision, but they're light and sensitive. And animals without the melanopsin and without those rods and cones, they were light insensitive. You could shine lights on them and nothing happened. But you can see here in this cartoon up here, this system starts in the eyeball and it goes into by the hypothalamus, and it deals with our circadian rhythms. So it's a very, very, very interesting system. Well, then you have to ask yourself, well, here's a system that can turn light on without any vision. How does the pain occur? How do you get discomfort? How do you get, actually, many people with photophobia say that it's painful. Light is painful. Well, you need the trigeminal system. And this is the same system that's active in migraine, the trigeminal system. The trigeminal system feeds the eye, but the same trigeminal system feeds the dura. So the covering of our brain gets fed by the same system. And it's the same system that is involved in migraine, where what we call, sometimes people called it the migraine generator. It's in the upper brain stem. So it's a very interesting, the trigeminal system is very interesting. It's pain. And then this study, which was done, located the melanopsin system and the visual system with the pain system, linked the two together. So, and then that system went off to the sensory cortex. But so these two things can explain where this light sensitivity or photophobia comes from. And it's a very, very interesting thing. Now, what's also interesting is that people who have photophobia and chronic photophobia, that means they have photophobia every single day, like this woman I have, okay? She had a higher incidence of depression and anxiety after that motor vehicle accident. She had migraines, and then she had this chronic light sensitivity. And we did a study where we looked at people who said, I have light sensitivity all the time. Every day I'm light sensitive. And they had a higher incidence of anxiety and depression. And what's interesting is and their photophobia, of course, was worse too. And if they didn't have photophobia, they were the same as normal controls, people who didn't have migraine or anything else. So if they were migraine but no photophobia, they were the same as controls, and the same in depression and anxiety. Now, what's interesting is that they did an experiment with animals, you know, little mice, and which I think is so interesting, okay? So they're mice, when they're born, they have no formed vision. All they have are those melanopsin cells going. That's all they have. You know, they're little mice, and they're really blind mice, okay? They're like three blind mice. They're blind mice, okay, when they're first born. And they did an experiment where they shined light on the mice. And the mice started squealing just as if they'd been taken away from their litter. So if you take a little newborn mouse and you take them away from their mom, they start squealing, making little squeaky noises. But But shining light on those little newborn mice with just the melanopsin cells, they made these squeaky little noises just like that. So the light was uncomfortable to them, even though they had no form vision and they just had this melanopsin pathway. And, you know, mice and rodents, they like the dark. They don't want to be in the light, right? And then they cut up their brains, and they could see that these little mice, the brains, showed up that the emotional centers were activated during that light, just the light. No pinching, probing, prodding, poking, nothing else but just the light. So we know that there is this little emotional connection with photophobia. So I think it's a real problem. Again, it's a symptom that's real. People don't make this stuff up. It's real, and that there is an explanation in our brains to help us understand that. And you can treat this photophobia. You can treat light sensitivity. If the eye is all inflamed, you can dilate the eye. One thing that I urge all my patients who have light sensitivity is don't wear dark glasses all the time, because you're just going to make this worse. It's like going to the matinee in the middle of the day all day long. You're just going to make it worse. You know, some people like put shades over their windows and shades everywhere, and that's just going to make this problem worse. Blacking out everything, it's going to make the problem worse. So you have to slowly get adapted to the light. And I always remark that we should treat the migraine headache, because if you can treat the migraine, underlying migraine, and like this patient, she has migraines, she has a photophobia, if I can get her headaches to get better, I might be able to help this photophobia light sensitivity as well. And then I always tell patients that green light is more comfortable. If you're light sensitive or you have a migraine and you see your doctor, have them use the green light, because it will be much more comfortable than using a white bright light. And I do this in my clinic routinely, because people are much more comfortable just using the green light. It's still a little uncomfortable, but it's not as bad as white light. And that's been shown in studies. Rami Burstein and his group and Nozeda have shown beautifully that that's a really true thing. And then we sometimes use tinted lenses, and FL41 was studied in migraine. Has anybody ever heard of FL41? Okay, so FL41 is a kind of a rose tinted lens, but it's not just the color. It's a special lens that blocks, guess what? Blue light from those melanopsin pathway. It blocks blue light. And it doesn't have to be pitch dark, thick coating on the lens. It can be very light, but it'll still block that wavelength. And the original experiment was done by a group in England, and probably, and they went to an orphanage or something like that, and they put these kids in these glasses, FL41, and then they put them in a different colored glass. I think it was a blue glass. And the kids that got put in the FL41, their headaches reduced by half. And, you know, there's no side effects to using this. It's such a good treatment. It's great for lots of people with migraine, but it's really good for people who've got light sensitivity. Does it work for everybody? No. It doesn't work for everybody. But if it works for a lot of people and there's no side effects, it's a really good treatment for prevention of migraine. Some people can get contact lenses that are made out of FL41. There are some companies that will actually make up contact lenses. And for people who are light sensitive due to cone disorders in their eye that cause them to be light sensitive, there are certain tinted lenses that help them too. So it's another treatment that can occur. Well, here's what FL41 looks like. You can see the tint is a little bit pink, orangey color. And it doesn't have to be real dark, it can be light. And it blocks the spectrum of the melanopsin light. And there are other technologies out there that are being developed to try to make it so not everything looks pink. There's some thin film technologies trying to get to block a certain wavelength of light that are in development. There are other treatments for photophobia. Some people have dry eyes, And just lubricating their eyes can be very, very helpful. People who have chronic migraine, meaning they have migraine more than 15 days a month, they have a high, and we're going to talk about that in a minute, they have a higher incidence of dry eyes, so that tears are really important. We've used botulinum toxin, onobotulinum toxin, for the treatment of chronic migraine, but we've even used it in people who've got chronic photophobia. So it is a good, it is a treatment that works for some people. Some people respond to anticonvulsants like gabapentin. And I always tell doctors to partner with a neurologist when you're treating migraine, because there may be other comorbidities you have to treat, like depression and anxiety, because we know that that can run with that chronic photophobia. And then sometimes we've done blocks. I had a woman who had very severe photophobia from a corneal injury. It's set up, and she had little migraine background. They tried her on all kinds of medicines, and all they did was make her dizzy, and she fell and broke her ankle. And we tried a sympathetic block. We blocked the sympathetics. It's the nervous system, the autonomic nervous system that goes up into the brain and eye, and we were able to get rid of some of the light sensitivity that was going on with her. So there are other treatments that are helpful for some people. All right, now the last topic I'm going to talk about is dry eyes. Can dry eye symptoms, now dry eyes are ubiquitous, and especially in Utah we have lots of dry eyes, but people who have chronic migraine, and today I just had a patient who told me for the first time, I had forgotten to ask her, you know, she has chronic migraine, she has dry, scratchy feeling in her eyes almost all the time. This is a 32-year-old woman that comes to the ophthalmologist and says, I've got all this eye pain, is something wrong with my eyes? Now she has a history of migraines that have become chronic, meaning she has more than 15 days of migraine or migraine-like headaches per month. Her eyes exam was normal, except she had a few reduced tears in her eyes, and we wondered, are these related? The thing I told you once, I said that the eyeball uses the same trigeminal system as the dura does. And in migraine, this trigeminal nucleus, we think this is where this kind of generation of migraine is occurring. Well, the input comes right from the eyeball to that center and also from the dura. And we know from studies that this dural sensitivity has a role to play in migraine peripherally. And then this is the central portion of migraine as well. And there are connections with the autonomic nervous system. But the eye and the dura, the covering of the brain, all come together in the same spot. So it makes sense that in migraine, if this is playing a role in migraine and revving up this trigeminal nucleus, why wouldn't the eye do the same thing? And if you had activation of the trigeminal system in your eye, which your cornea, the you know the clear part of your eye, is just jam-packed with little trigeminal nerve endings, that is going to feed right into your migraine center and make your headaches go crazy, right? So, is that true, or am I just making that stuff up? Well, of course I'm not going to make it up, but I'm going to try to convince you. We did a study where we took people with chronic migraine and controls that didn't have migraine, and we did a dry eye questionnaire. We asked all of them, all the dry eye, does your eye feel dry and scratchy? Do you, you know, get some excessive tearing and all these kind of questions. And we compared these people with chronic migraine to controls, and we found that their eye pain score, this dry eye score, was high versus controls, which was normal. And in the same population, in Utah, where everybody has a little bit of dry eye. But we tested their basal tear film, their corneal sensitivity, their tear film breakup time, all these tests that you can do to determine if you've got bad dry eye, and those were normal. And then what we did was we did a study of the corneal nerves. So the trigeminal nerve goes from the trigeminal ganglion and goes into the eyeball and into the orbit and feeds the whole eyeball and the cornea. The cornea has the most trigeminal nerve nerves anywhere. And what we found was, if this one is a control, you can see, look at, see how they have all these little lines here? These are all corneal nerves, okay? But in chronic migraine, the nerve density was definitely reduced compared to normal, and the nerve fiber length was a little bit shorter. See how long that fiber is versus another fiber, which is a lot shorter. And the branching pattern was about the same. We found this, and then this last year, another group found the same thing. So we think that the trigeminal system is affected. I don't know if it's the migraine process that's going on, the whole migraine process going on that's affecting the corneal nerves, or is it continuous trigeminal stimulation, or is there a biochemical thing going on, or is the migraine central sensitization? And I know any of you who are here to talk about the pathophysiology of migraine found that this central sensitization can lead to chronic firing of pain everywhere. It leads to allodynia. People get migraine headaches, and then even after their headache is gone, their head hurts just to touch it. Well, maybe that's what's going on in the eye, that the eye is hurting like spontaneously and is part of the migraine. So it's that part we haven't completely worked out yet. I do believe, though, if we have these symptoms, we should try to treat them, because maybe it will make migraines less frequent, and that we can treat the dry eyes. We can maybe make migraines get better. At least that's what I'm doing for my patients. We need to do a study to see if that really works, but I think that's an important thing that we can do. So what can you do about migraine and all these visual symptoms? Well, first, educate yourself and your family by coming to headache school or listening to our broadcasts. You can participate in research studies. If we have research studies, please, we'd love to have you participate. And I would like to draw your attention to the American Migraine Foundation, which is a wonderful website, www.americanmigrainefoundation.org. And there you're going to find all kinds of handouts. Every week they have new great handouts about migraine, living with migraine, all the different topics of migraine. They talk about photophobia. They can talk about all kinds of things. I'll show you a picture of their website. Migraine is a disabling disease. And here's just a snapshot of some of the topics, understanding caffeine headaches. Here's one on photophobia or light sensitivity and migraine. Here's one on treating migraine with meditation. Here's one on 5 ways to combat your migraine for the new year, medication overuse headache, a timeline of a migraine attack, something that we just talked about today, the timeline of a migraine attack. So this is a great website and a wonderful place. I'm going to end with this slide. This is the patron saint of migraine, Saint Dimphna. You didn't know that migraine had a patron saint, but it does. And of course, she's using an experienced rabbit to heal somebody's migraine. And sometimes I feel like I'm kind of using rabbits. I'm doing the best I can. I wish I had more tools in my box to fix everybody who had migraine. But I think that with research and with energy and attention to this very common disorder, we can make a difference, and we can actually get people to feel better and do better. So I hope you, these aren't all the visual symptoms of migraine, but at least these are some of the most common ones: aura, photophobia, and visual snow that we talked about tonight, and then maybe this dry eye symptom problem, especially in chronic migraine, that we might be able to get a handle on. I wanted to spend a couple minutes if people had questions, so that we always try to leave time at the end of all of these to answer questions. Anybody with a question? Yes.
When you were talking about this spreading depression, you talked about like a lack of oxygen.
Well, it's not a lack of oxygen, but it's a electrical activity that occurs that silences the brain. It's not oxygen per se, although it can be a little bit of, and if it can be a little bit of that, but that's not the primary process. It's our brains have got electrical activity going all the time, but when you get a spreading depression, it's like the brain goes silent for a little period of time, and then it goes back to firing again. But during that time, there are changes that are occurring in the brain function. It's not functioning normally. And that's where we think this aura comes from. We're not completely sure, but I showed you the picture of the PET scan with the aura coming out of the occipital lobe. We think that that's what's going on. We don't know for sure, but that's what we think is going on.
Okay. Thank you.
Good. Any other questions?
Yeah. I don't know how the PET, what is that?
A PET scan?
Uh-huh.
It's a scan that doesn't just image the anatomy of the brain. It images some of the function of the brain. And so we use PET imaging for many reasons. Like in dementia, for example, we use it to show areas of brains that are not functioning properly.
Is it like that picture on the school? Yeah, the handout that's got
yeah.
the colors on it.
Yeah. That's a PET scan. That's partly a PET scan. Yeah. We're like ahead of the game here. Yes. Okay.
Where do you advertise your research, or if you have research?
So our projects are on our website. We have one right now on medication overuse, people who are overusing medication. There's a medication overuse treatment trial going on right now. We have an autonomic and post-traumatic headache treatment trial or evaluation trial going on. We have a trial right now going on using that thin filmed technology for light sensitivity. And if you're interested, you can give me your name and I will get you in contact with the study coordinator of seeing whether one of the trials would work for you. But we try to advertise them on our website, and maybe that's a really good idea. We should link to the trial section from our Headache School webpage. I'll ask our famous web person, Lauren Brown, the most amazing woman in the world, if she could link to our trial website. That's a really good idea. Thank you for bringing that up. Yeah?
You mentioned that FL41 blocks melanopsin.
Mm-hmm.
So would that potentially disrupt circadian rhythms if you wear those a lot?
It's not that strong that it's going to disrupt your circadian rhythm. However, some people have said for people who have difficulty sleeping after shift work, maybe they should be using the FL41 blocking so that their brain gets more used to a different time period. I mean, that was what somebody suggested once, but I don't know if that would work or not. But some people have thought maybe shift workers could use that to help their brains get used to their different times that they have to work. People work shift work. That's a hard thing on your brain, is to work different shifts. And for migraine people, whoa, it's a bad one.
So I have a question about that. So isn't there a blue...
With the
blue tint or a pink tint?
The FL41 looks more like a pinkish tint.
That's what these are.
It's a very light tint. You've got a very light tint because you can't quite see it.
She
yeah.
gave you some options, which intensity?
Yeah, intensity to use. And I tell my patients, use the lightest tint because you don't want to run around and, I mean, people want to see your eyes and that's part of your communication and, and all that. So. So
I heard at one place they say, well, we do the blue tint, but not the pink tint.
And okay, it's mainly you want to know what wavelength they're blocking. That's what you want to know. The color of FL41 is on the pink side, but the thing we're interested in is what wavelength is being blocked. That's what we're interested in. And we're trying to block the blue light, which we think is most involved in light sensitivity and migraine. And that's what that study was showing us. Remember the study that was done by Dr. Good in England. Well, thank you tonight. I'm excited that you get to now have some headache yoga, and thank you for coming. And I think it was kind of a fun night. We talked about a lot of really interesting problems. Okay, good night.